On the 23rd of November 1975, a lock-up garage door in Berwick Road, Preston, was noticed banging open in the wind. Mrs. Mildred Atkinson, who spotted it as she went to pick up her Sunday papers, glanced inside and saw what she took to be a drunk lying on the floor. It wasn't a drunk. It was a dead prostitute. Joan Harrison was a chronic alcoholic and morphine addict. Though she was only 26, her habitual abuse of drugs and her body had given her a raddled 40-year-old look. Her life was a chaotic mess. There was a man who let her live with him, but she was also a frequent inmate of St. Mary's Hostel for the homeless. She spent most of the 20th of November at the hostel, slipping out for drinks from time to time while the pubs were open. After the afternoon closing time, the hostel let her go and lie down to sober up, as she was very drunk. At about 4 p.m., a lucky, or desperate, male resident found the opportunity to enjoy sex with her. In the evening, she went out to ask for more drinking money from the man she lived with. He refused to give it her, so she stormed out of the house and was last seen alive walking toward the town centre at 10:30 p.m. She was wearing a green three-quarter-length coat with a fake fur collar, a blue jumper and a yellow tank top, brown trousers and suede boots. She carried a handbag. When her body was found in the garage, the handbag was missing. One boot had been pulled off. Her trousers, pants and tights had been pulled down and right off one leg. Her breasts had been exposed. She had been felled by a violent blow to the back of the head, apparently with a hammer. Her face, neck, body and legs were marked by severe kicking and stamping. One breast had been bitten by an assailant with a gap between his front teeth. Swabs showed that she had been sexually taken, both normally and anally. Now, that hammer blow to the back of the head evoked interest over in Leeds. Wilma McCann had been killed by a hammer blow to the head 3 weeks earlier, and her body had then suffered mutilation. Detective Chief Superintendent Brooks of Preston, in charge of the Joan Harrison inquiry, was approached by Detective Superintendent Hoban of Leeds, in charge of what was becoming the Yorkshire Ripper inquiry. At this point, the comparison seemed inconclusive. Both victims were prostitutes. Both were assaulted with a hammer or hammer-like weapon from behind. Both were then brutalized. But Wilma McCann had not been robbed, her handbag laid beside her. And though semen had been found on her outer clothing, she had not been internally assaulted. It seemed most probable that the two were victims of different killers. Yet Joan Harrison's death was to have a vitally important impact in stalling the Ripper investigation, for the semen in her vagina and anus came from a secreta of blood group B. Only a minority of men are of that blood group, and not all are secretas, whose blood grouping could at that time be detected from samples of semen or saliva. A few years later, it would seem that a blood group B secreting man was actually claiming anonymously to be both the Ripper and Joan Harrison's murderer. And since the press had never been told about the identified blood group of Joan's killer, it seemed that his claim must be valid. Still, for the time being, Leeds police kept their minds focused on events in their own patch. When I first went to Leeds in 1966... The Gaiety was a run-down cinema near the bottom of the long hill, Roundhay Road, running through the depressed Hare Hills district of sooty brick back-to-back terraces. A couple of huge old nonconformist chapels with shrieking wayside pulpits didn't really brighten the district. It only picked up as the hill levelled out a bit, further north, where shops lined the road. Those were the palmy days of Leeds United and the Charlton brothers. The Hare Hills Conservative Association and Jack Charlton's nearby sportswear business made a constant happy reminder of the great footballer's innocent belief that membership of the association was perfectly compatible with endorsing electioneering pamphlets for the Labour Party, since nobody ever thought of a Conservative Association as political. It was just a pleasant drinking club. By the mid-1970s, when I'd left Leeds and only occasionally came back from abroad to visit it during the summer, the Gaiety had been rebuilt as a clean, modern, red-brick entertainment centre. There was a can-can dancer on a sign outside, and a low wall surrounding an open space in front of the building, abutting on the fork of Roundhay Road and Gledhill Road. There were bars and entertainment rooms and live entertainment, and one day, when I was driving up to see my daughters in Roundhay, and realised I could only just catch a pub lunch before closing time, I stopped and went in. The entertainment was strip. The Gaiety was sleazy. Nonetheless, it was the favoured watering hole of the Morley roof repairer Sidney Jackson and his wife Emily. They had lived at the rural end of Morley, on the edge of the Leeds conurbation, since 1969, and had habitually gone out pubbing most nights after the tragic death of their 15-year-old son Derek in 1971. He had fallen to the pavement from a bedroom window. This terrible accident brought the Jacksons closer together. Their marriage had gone through its ups and downs. Both realised that Mrs. Jackson's sexual appetite was greater than Sidney could satisfy. Once they had separated for 18 months. Now they tacitly agreed that Mrs. Jackson should be free to find and amuse herself with casual lovers at places like the Gaiety. Mr. Jackson had the courage, confidence, and affection to tolerate this without feeling that his own pride rested desperately on exclusive possession of his wife's genitals. The arrangement was made the easier in that Mr. Jackson did not drive. He owned a comma van with a ladder on a roof rack for business, but Emily drove him around in it from gale-torn slates to frost-cracked tiles on his work, and she drove them in and out of Leeds for their nights on the town. She also used the van as her love nest if she picked up boyfriends who lacked their own transport. On the 20th of January, 1976, 42-year-old Mrs. Jackson dressed carefully for her evening out, as usual. She wore a skirt, a tight blue and white sweater, a white cardigan, slingback shoes, and a checked overcoat. At 5'6", with a full figure, she knew she would find what she wanted at the Gaiety, and after a quick lager at the bar with her husband, she went out to the open space and chatted for a few minutes with a prostitute sitting on the low wall. Then she spotted a hard-topped Land Rover parked nearby. The driver seemed to be dozing, a bearded, round-faced, 50-ish man who'd come straight off a building site, judging from his clothes. Mrs. Jackson hurried over and had a quick word with him. She jumped into the van, and it pulled away up the Gledhill Road. At closing time, Sidney Jackson came out of the bar to look for Emily. Her comma van was in the car park. Emily was not to be seen. With a sigh, Mr. Jackson made his way off to find a taxi home. Emily would drive herself back when she'd finished frolicking. But she never did. An hour after she left the Gaiety with the workman in the Land Rover, she was again on the streets. Another driver in a saloon car picked her up and drove her to a little patch of waste land between two disused buildings in an alley off the bottom of Roundhay Road near Sheepscar. It was a non-residential section, dominated by crumbling light industry. There he persuaded her to get out of the car and hold a torch for him as he looked under its bonnet. He was to claim later that the smell of her cheap perfume inside the vehicle was intolerable. As she bent over the car engine, he hit her twice in the back of the head with a hammer. Then he dragged her into the shadows and pulled her blouse and bra up above her breasts. Taking a Phillips screwdriver, he stabbed her 52 times. In the neck, in the breasts, around the genitals, in the back. He stamped on the body before departing, leaving the ribbed rubber sole mark of his heavy boot on the thigh, matching a similar boot mark in sand beside the body. He had small, delicate feet. His shoe size was 7 or 7½, certainly not more than 8. He covered Mrs. Jackson with her overcoat, and he drove away, satisfied that there was not a spot of blood on his clothes. Emily Jackson's handbag was found near her body, and the fact that she had not been robbed linked this murder with the earlier killing of Wilma McCann. So did the fact that seminal swabs taken from her vagina showed that she had had intercourse some time before she was killed, presumably with the bearded labourer in the Land Rover. But her killer had not ravished her. The Jacksons' neighbours were in for a double shock when the news broke that Emily had been murdered. For it also transpired that the good wife and mother, and there seems little doubt that in her way she was both, had also become a prostitute. When money ran short before Christmas, she started turning her preferred form of evening's entertainment to financial advantage and picking up cash customers rather than temporary sporting boyfriends. So extraordinary is our culture's mindset that it can seem as appalling to learn that a respected neighbour practices the eternally popular trade of Rahab as to hear that she has suffered the extraordinary fate of being murdered. And, deplorably, it may change our attitude to her murder from one of sympathy to one of almost suggesting that she deserved her fate. As it happened, the next victim selected by the Yorkshire Ripper was another woman from the streets of the same run-down part of Leeds. Marcella Claxton, the black girl described by police as one removed from a gorilla, was picked up near Roundhay Road and battered in Roundhay Park that April. But she survived, giving the police an excellent description of her assailant. The Ripper was seriously alarmed. And for the rest of 1976, he kept out of the red light districts and attacked no more women. But the police didn't know this. As 1977 began, 28-year-old Irene Richardson, another Leeds prostitute, was at a pretty low ebb. Her 4- and 5-year-old daughters had been taken into foster homes. She'd arranged to marry her boyfriend, Stephen Bray, on January the 22nd, an arrangement that came to nothing when neither turned up at the registry because neither had informed the other that their former marriages were still undissolved. She had no money and no proper home. She was putting on weight with the fried and starchy diet of poverty. By February, Stephen had left Leeds and gone back to Ireland. On February the 5th, Irene left a rooming house in Chapeltown that had promised her a bed for the night, making her way to Tiffany's Disco, where Stephen had previously worked as a doorman. She was dressed as well as she could manage for Tiffany's barred jeans and denim. It seemed like a stroke of good luck when a clean white saloon car slowed and stopped beside her. Irene didn't ask what the driver was after. In her part of Chapeltown and its environs, it could only be one thing, and she hopped straight into the passenger seat.
"I might not have wanted you,"
the young man in the driving seat remarked. "That's all right," Irene responded hastily. "I'll give you a good time." Without demur, the man with the tightly curled black hair and neatly trimmed springy beard swung the car in the direction of Roundhay Road, where Mrs. Jackson had cruised, and up to Roundhay Park and the Soldiers' Field, where Marcella Claxton had been attacked. Like Marcella, Scottish Irene crouched in the grass to urinate before getting down to business. As she did so, a hammer was brought fiercely down onto the back of her head 3 times. Next morning, an accountant out jogging through the park saw a woman lying behind the pavilion. He went over to ask if she was all right. She wasn't. After silencing her with the hammer, the killer had pulled her yellow skirt up, removed one of the 2 pairs of pants she wore, and pulled the other, with her tights, off her buttock and down her right leg. Then he had stabbed her in the neck and throat, and made 3 deep gashes with a Stanley knife down her abdomen through which her intestines protruded. Of all his crimes, this was the one which was most similar to those of his prototypical namesake, Jack the Ripper. But tidier than the great Victorian, this man had then placed Irene's boots neatly across her thighs and placed her imitation suede overcoat to cover her buttocks and legs, leaving only her feet showing. He had killed 3 times and assaulted once in Leeds, picking up all his victims from the street women of inner North Leeds. I lived in Leeds for 6 years and never once consciously saw a prostitute. This man knew what he was looking for and where to find it. He had begun 1977 as he intended to go on. He would branch out from Leeds. But this was to be one of his great years of murder.